Chapter 12 of Windsor Castle, Book 4. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Windsor Castle, Book 4, by William Harrison Ainsworth. How Wolsey was disgraced by the King. On the following day, a reconciliation took place between the King and Anne Boleyn. During a ride in the Great Park with his royal brother, Suffolk not only convinced him of the groundlessness of his jealousy, but contrived to incense him strongly against Wolsey. Thus the Queen and the Cardinal lost the momentary advantage they had gained, while Anne's power was raised yet higher. Yielding to her entreaties not to see Catherine again, nor to hold further conference with Wolsey until the sentence of the court should be pronounced, Henry left the castle that very day, and proceeded to his palace of Bridewell. The distress of the unhappy Queen at this sudden revolution of affairs may be conceived. Distrusting Wolsey, and putting her sole reliance on heaven and the goodness of her cause, she withdrew to Blackfriars, where she remained till the court met. As to the Cardinal himself, driven desperate by his situation, and exasperated by the treatment he had experienced, he resolved at whatever risk to thwart Henry's schemes and revenge himself upon Anne Boleyn. Thus matters continued till the court met as before in the Parliament chamber at Blackfriars. On this occasion Henry was present and took his place under a cloth of estate, the Queen sitting at some distance below him. Opposite them were the legates, with the Archbishop of Canterbury and the whole of the bishops. The aspect of the assemblage was grave and anxious. Many eyes were turned on Henry, who looked gloomy and menacing, but the chief object of interest was the Queen, who, though pale as death, had never in her highest days of power worn a more majestic and dignified air than on this occasion. The proceedings of the court then commenced, and the King being called by the crier, he immediately answered to the summons. Catherine was next called, and instead of replying, she marched towards the canopy beneath which the King was seated, prostrated herself, and poured forth a most pathetic and eloquent appeal to him, at the close of which she arose, and making a profound reverence, walked out of the court, leaning upon the arm of her general receiver, Griffith. Henry desired the crier to call her back, but she would not return, and seeing the effect produced by her address upon the auditory, he endeavoured to efface it by an eulogium on her character and virtues, accompanied by an expression of deep regret at the step he was compelled to take in separating himself from her. But his hypocrisy availed him little, and the speech was received with looks of ill-disguised incredulity. Some further discourse then took place between the Archbishop of Canterbury and the Bishop of Rochester, but as the Queen had absented herself, the court was adjourned to the next day, when it again met, and as she did not then appear, though summoned, she was pronounced contumacious. After repeated adjournments, the last session was held, and judgment demanded on the part of the King, when Campeggio, as had been arranged between him and Wolsey, declined to pronounce it until he had referred the matter to the Pope, and the court was dissolved. About 2 months after this event, during which time the legate's commission had been revoked, while Henry was revolving the expediency of accomplishing the divorce through the medium of his own ecclesiastical courts, and without reference to that of Rome, a dispatch was received from the Pope by the two cardinals, requiring them to cite the King to appear before him by attorney on a certain day. At the time of the arrival of this instrument, Campeggio chanced to be staying with Wolsey at his palace at Esher, and as the King was then holding his court at Windsor, they both set out for the castle on the following day, attended by a retinue of nearly 100 horsemen, splendidly equipped. It was now the middle of September, and the woods, instead of presenting one uniform mass of green, glowed with an infinite variety of lovely tints. And yet, despite the beauty of the scene, there was some melancholy in witnessing the decline of the year, as marked by those old woods, and by the paths that led through them, so thickly strewn with leaves. Wolsey was greatly affected. "These noble trees will ere long bereft of all their glories," he thought, "and so, most likely, will it be with me, and perhaps my winter may come sooner than theirs." The Cardinal and his train had crossed Staines Bridge, and passing through Egham, had entered the great park near Ingleford Green. They were proceeding along the high ridge, overlooking the woody region between it and the castle, when a joyous shout in the glades beneath reached them, and looking down, they saw the King accompanied by Anne Boleyn, and attended by his falconers and a large company of horsemen, pursuing the sport of hawking. The royal party appeared so much interested in their sport that they did not notice the cardinal and his train, and were soon out of sight. But as Wolsey descended Snow Hill and entered the long avenue, he heard the trampling of horses at a little distance, and shortly afterwards Henry and Anne issued from out the trees. They were somewhat more than a bowshot in advance of the cardinal, but instead of halting till he came up, the king had no sooner ascertained who it was than, dispatching a messenger to the castle, who was seen galloping swiftly down the avenue. He rode off with Anne Boleyn towards the opposite side of the park. Though deeply mortified by the slight, Wolsey concealed his vexation from his brother cardinal, and pursued his way to the castle, before which he presently arrived. The gate was thrown open at his approach, but he had scarcely entered the lower ward when Sir Henry Norris, the king's groom of the stole, advanced to meet him, and with a sorrowful expression of countenance said that his royal master had so many guests at the castle that he could not accommodate him in his train. "I understand your drift, sir," replied Wolsey. "You would tell me I am not welcome. Well, then, His Eminence Cardinal Campeggio and myself must take up our lodging at some hostel in the town, for it is necessary we should see the king." "If your grace is content to dismiss your attendants," said Norris in a low tone, "you and Cardinal Campeggio can be lodged in Henry III's tower. Thus much I will take upon me, but I dare not admit you to the royal lodgings." Wolsey tried to look unconcerned, and calling to his gentleman usher, George Cavendish, gave him some instructions in a low voice, upon which the other immediately placed himself at the head of the retinue, and ordered them to quit the castle with him, leaving only the jester, Patch, to attend upon his master. Campeggio's attendants, being comparatively speaking few in number, were allowed to remain, and his litter was conveyed to Henry III's tower, a fortification standing, as already stated, in the south side of the lower ward, near the edge of the dry moat surrounding the round tower. At the steps of this tower, Wolsey dismounted, and was about to follow Campeggio into the doorway, when Will Summers, who had heard of his arrival, stepped forward, and with a salutation of mock formality said, "I am sure it will grieve the king, my master, not to be able to accommodate your grace's train. But since it is larger than his own, you will scarcely blame his want of hospitality." "Nor the courtesy of his attendants," rejoined Wolsey sharply. "I am in no mood for thy jesting now. Stand aside, sirrah, or I will have the rod applied to thy back." "Take care the king does not apply the rod to your own, Lord Cardinal," retorted Will Summers. "If he scourges you according to your deserts, your skin will be redder than your robe." And his mocking laugh pursued Wolsey like the hiss of a snake into the tower. Some 2 hours after this, Henry and his attendants returned from the chase. The king seemed in a blithe humour, and Wolsey saw him laugh heartily as Will Summers pointed with his bauble towards Henry III's tower. The cardinal received no invitation to the royal banquet, and the answer to his solicitation for an interview was that he and Campeggio would be received in the presence chamber on the following morning, but not before. That night a great revel was held in the castle. Masking, dancing, and feasting filled up the evening, and the joyous sounds and strains reached Wolsey in his seclusion, and forced him to contrast it with his recent position, when he would only have been second to the king in the entertainment. He laid his head upon his pillow, but not to rest, and while tossing feverishly about his couch, he saw the arras with which the walls were covered move, and a tall, dark figure step from behind it. The cardinal would have awakened his jester, who slept in a small truckle bed at his feet, but the strange visitor motioned him to be still. "You may conjecture who I am, Cardinal," he said, "but in case you should doubt, I will tell you. I am Herne the Hunter. And now to my errand. There is a damsel whom you once saw in the forest near the Great Lake, and whom you promised to befriend. You can assist her now. Tomorrow it may be out of your power." "I have enough to do to aid myself, without meddling with what concerns me not," said Wolsey. "This damsel does concern you," cried Herne. "Read this, and you will see in what way." And he tossed a letter to Wolsey, who glanced at it by the light of the lamp. "Ha! Is it so?" he exclaimed. "Is she—" "Hush," cried Herne, "or you will wake this sleeper. It is as you suppose. Will you not aid her now? Will you not bestow some of your treasure upon her before it is wholly wrested from you by the king? I will do aught you wish, secretly and swiftly." "Go then to my palace at Esher," cried the cardinal. "Take this key to my treasurer. It is the key of my coffers. Bid him deliver to you the 6 caskets in the cabinet in the gilt chamber. Here is a token by which he will know that you came from me," he added, delivering him a small chain of gold, "for it has been so agreed between us. but you will be sure to give the treasurer to Mabel." "Fear nothing," replied Herne. And stretching forth his hand to receive the key and the chain, he glided behind the tapestry and disappeared. This strange incident gave some diversion to Wolsey's thought, but ere long they returned to their former channel. Sleep would not be summoned, and as soon as the first glimpse of day appeared, he arose, and wrapping his robe around him, left his room and ascended a winding staircase leading to the roof of the tower. The morning promised to be fine, but it was then hazy, and the greater part of the forest was wrapped in mist. The castle, however, was seen to great advantage. Above Wolsey rose the vast fabric of the round tower, on the summit of which the broad standard was at that moment being unfurled, while the different battlements and towers arose majestically around him. But Wolsey's gaze rested chiefly upon the exquisite mausoleum lying immediately beneath him, in which he had partly prepared for himself a magnificent monument. A sharp pang shook him as he contemplated it, and he cried aloud, "My very tomb will be wrested from me by this rapacious monarch, and after all my care and all my cost, I know not where I shall rest my bones." Saddened by the reflection, he descended to his chamber, and again threw himself on the couch. But Wolsey was not the only person in the castle who had passed a sleepless night. Of the host of his enemies, many had been kept awake by the anticipation of his downfall on the morrow, and among these was Anne Boleyn, who had received an assurance from the king that her enmity should at length be fully gratified. At the appointed hour, the two cardinals proceeded to the royal lodgings. They were detained for some time in the antechamber, where Wolsey was exposed to the taunts and sneers of the courtiers who had lately so servilely fawned upon him. At length, they were ushered into the presence chamber, at the upper end of which, beneath a canopy emblazoned with the royal arms woven in gold, sat Henry, with Anne Boleyn on his right hand. At the foot of the throne stood Will Somers, and near him the Dukes of Richmond and Suffolk. Norfolk, Rochford, and a number of other nobles, all open enemies of Wolsey, were also present. Henry watched the advance of the cardinals with a stern look, and after they had made an obeisance to him, he motioned them to rise. "You have sought an interview with me, my lords," he said with suppressed rage. "What would you?" "We have brought an instrument to you, my liege," said Wolsey, "which has just been received from His Holiness the Pope." "Declare its nature," said Henry. "It is a citation," replied Wolsey, "enjoining your highness to appear by attorney in the papal court under a penalty of 10,000 ducats. And he presented a parchment stamped with the great seal of Rome to the king, who glanced his eye fiercely over it and then dashed it to the ground with an explosion of fury terrible to hear and to witness. "Ha! By St. George," he cried, "am I as nothing, that the Pope dares to insult me thus?" "It is a mere judicial form, your majesty," interposed Campeggio, "and is chiefly sent by His Holiness to let you know we have no further jurisdiction in the matter of the divorce." "I will take care you have not, nor His Holiness either," roared the king. "By my father's head, he shall find I will no longer be trifled with." "But my liege," cried Campeggio. "Peace," cried the king. "I will hear no apologies nor excuses. The insult has been offered, and cannot be effaced. As for you, Wolsey—" "Sire!" exclaimed the cardinal, shrinking before the whirlwind of passion, which seemed to menace his utter extermination. "As for you, I say," pursued Henry, extending his hand towards him, while his eyes flashed fire, "who by your outrageous pride have so long overshadowed our honour, who by your insatiate avarice and appetite for wealth have oppressed our subjects, who by your manifold acts of bribery and extortion have impoverished our realm, and by your cruelty and partiality have subverted the due course of justice and turned it to your ends, the time has come when you shall receive due punishment for your offences." "You wrong me, my dear liege," cried Wolsey abjectly. "These are the accusations of my enemies. Grant me a patient hearing, and I will explain all." "I would not sharpen the king's resentment against you, Lord Cardinal," said Anne Boleyn, "for it is keen enough. But I cannot permit you to say that these charges are merely hostile. Those who would support the king's honour and dignity must desire to see you removed from his councils." "I am ready to take thy place, Lord Cardinal," said Will Somers, "and will exchange my bauble for thy chancellor's mace, and my fool's cap for thy cardinal's hat." "Peace," thundered the king. "Stand not between me and the object of my wrath. Your accusers are not one but many, Wolsey. Nay, the whole of my people cry out for justice against you, and they shall have it. But you shall hear the charges they bring. Firstly, contrary to our prerogative, and for your own advancement and profit, you have obtained authority legatine from the Pope, by which authority you have not only spoiled and taken away their substance from many religious houses, but have usurped much of our own jurisdiction. You have also made a treaty with the King of France for the Pope without our consent, and concluded another friendly treaty with the Duke of Ferrara under our great seal and in our name without our warrant. And furthermore, you have presumed to couple yourself with our royal self in your letters and instructions, as if you were on an equality with us. Ha, ha! The King and I would have you do thus. The King and I give you our hearty thanks. Ran it not so, Cardinal? Cried Will Somers. You will soon win the cap and bells. In exercise of your legatine authority, pursued the King, you have given away benefices, contrary to our crown and dignity, for the which you are in danger of forfeiture of your lands and goods. A premunire, Cardinal, cried Will Somers. A premunire! Ha, ha! Then it has been your practice to receive all the ambassadors to our court first at your own palace, continued Henry, to hear their charges and intentions, and to instruct them as you might see fit. You have also so practiced that all our letters sent from beyond sea have first come to your own hands, by which you have acquainted yourself with their contents, and compelled us and our council to follow your devices. You have also written to all our ambassadors abroad in your own name concerning our affairs, without our authority, and received letters in return from them by which you have sought to compass your own purposes. By your ambition and pride you have undone many of our poor subjects, have suppressed religious houses and received their possessions, have seized upon the goods of wealthy spiritual men deceased, constrained all ordinaries yearly to compound with you, have gotten riches for yourself and servants by subversion of the laws, and by abuse of your authority in causing divers pardons of the Pope to be suspended until you, by promise of a yearly pension, chose to revive them, and also by crafty and untrue tales have sought to create dissension among our nobles. That we can all avouch for, cried Suffolk. It was never merry in England while there were cardinals among us. Of all men in England, your grace should be the last to say so, rejoined Wolsey, for if I had not been cardinal, you would not have had a head upon your shoulders to utter the taunt. No more of this, cried the King. You have misdemeaned yourself in our court by keeping up as great state in our absence as if we had been there in person, and presumptuously have dared to join it and print your badge, the cardinal's hat, under our arms, graven on our coins struck at York. And lastly, whenever in open parliament allusion hath been made to heresies and erroneous sects, you have failed to correct and notice them, to the danger of the whole body of good and Christian people of this our realm. This last charge ought to win me favour in the eyes of one who professes the opinions of Luther, said Wolsey to Anne. But I deny it, as I do all the rest. I will listen to no defence, Wolsey, replied the King. I will make you a terrible example to others how they offend us and our laws hereafter. Do not condemn me unheard, cried the Cardinal, prostrating himself. I have heard too much, and I will hear no more, cried the King fiercely. I dismiss you from my presence for ever. If you are innocent, as you aver, justice will be done you. If you are guilty, as I believe you to be, look not for leniency from me, for I will show you none. And seating himself, he turned to Anne, and said in a low tone, Are you content, sweetheart? I am, she replied. I shall not now break my vow. False cardinal, she added aloud, your reign is at an end. Your own may not be much longer, madam, rejoined Wolsey bitterly. The shadow of the axe, he added, pointing to the reflection of a partisan on the floor, is at your feet. Ere long it may rise to the head. And, accompanied by Campeggio, he slowly quitted the presence chamber. Thus ends the fourth book of the Chronicle of Windsor Castle. End of chapter 12. End of Windsor Castle, book 4, by William Harrison Ainsworth.